blood pressure is two numbers. Systolic blood pressure is the pressure generated when your heart squeezes. It's the pressure that your blood vessels are seeing when that blood is being pumped through. The higher the pressure in the blood vessels, the harder the heart has to pump. The bottom number is from when the heart relaxes. So hypertension is when the blood pressure is above 130 over 80 in a consistent manner. That's hypertension. High blood pressure is extremely common. It increases in prevalence as we get older. Also, genetics play a key role.
Among the factors which contribute to hypertension are those that relate to our health behavior, whether it's our sleep, our stress, our diet, and/or our physical activity. We also know that there are psychological factors such as having a history of depression or anxiety, loneliness, discrimination, interpersonal stress. Over time, those experiences lead to elevations in your hormone levels, including the hormone cortisol, which do elevate blood pressure.
Hypertension, especially when it goes untreated, has a number of effects on our body. Risk for stroke, vascular dementia, heart attacks, congestive heart failure. It can affect the kidneys. It can affect the vasculature down to the leg, contributing to amputations. It can also affect the eyes and can lead to blindness. We do a thorough history to understand people's diet, not just how much salt they're taking in, but also how much fiber, how much fruits and vegetables, processed foods. We'll also think about their physical activity. We also investigate sleep apnea. If we can improve people's diet and exercise and address sleep apnea, we do better in terms of controlling blood pressure.
There are other techniques such as stress management and mindfulness, which are shown based on significant evidence to be effective.
When those things are not enough, then we think about medications.
But it's hard to do all the right healthy things that we know keep our body in check. So we've seen that there are many different aspects of hypertension which affect different segments of the population more than others.
This happens more so in the Black community and especially among young Black men. So when I think about the potential to really meet patients where they're at, I think about a diverse care team who the patient identifies with and who sees them as a trusted messenger. We're partnering with community organizations, community leaders, to provide people with information about high blood pressure and then to connect them to services.
Sometimes that means going into churches, going into barbershops, and meeting people where they're at.
There's a lot of barriers for people to get to appointments, and if we're thinking about people who are experiencing health disparities, how are they getting to their visits? What kind of time off from work or childcare is needed? What's the stress like with traffic, pay to park, waiting in the waiting room? And home blood pressure monitoring using digital health tools is really a way forward that we see as being extremely successful. What we've tried to do is formalize that into a remote blood pressure management programs where we give everyone a home blood pressure cuff. We give them a mechanism to transmit that data into our health system, provide a centralized blood pressure management team that can reach out to them on a weekly basis, and then to formulate with the patient a therapeutic plan.
We also have other techniques we've used and other approaches, such as ecological momentary assessment, which is when a patient would complete questionnaires on an app on their phone, whether it's related to their stress that day or related to their quality of life and blood pressure management.
You want to have care that is convenient, that's trusted, that's patient-centered, and that's going to get your needs met. And we've found that through our digital health programs, when we're mindful of what the patient experiences, what the needs are, we can deliver that in a better package.